السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. الإمام أبو داود رحمه الله reported in his Sunan the well-known narration of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. In which he said that I used to write down everything that I heard from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Everything that I heard him say, I would write it down. So obviously, the non-Muslims, the mushrikeen, Quraysh, they didn't like this. Whereas writing something down is a means of preserving it. One of the means, not the only, but one of the means. You can memorize something by heart, you can write it down, you can pay attention and focus, and you can memorize something through actions, and pass it on and hand it down through actions, etc. So they didn't like what I was doing, writing down things that the Prophet said and did. So they came to me once and they said, using one of the tricks or the doubts for me to divert from Islam, they said, you write down everything Muhammad says? And he's a man, just like me and you. This man, Muhammad, he's angry sometimes, and he's happy sometimes. And yet and still, you don't make any prejudice with regards to what you write down. You write all of it down. So he says, as if this doubt or what they said, maybe it made a little bit of sense, or maybe it had a bit of an effect on me, a little doubtful. So he went back to the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, and he complained to him and he informed him what they said. So the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, "Uktub." He said, "Don't necessarily listen to them, instead just write it down. Listen to me, write down what I say." For الذي نفسي بيدي, he says, "Because I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one whose hand my soul is, لا يخرج منه إلى الحق." Okay, man qala alayhi salatu wasalam. He says, "Because the only thing that I say is truth. Nothing comes out of my mouth except for the haq. I.e., so don't differentiate between what I say and what I do. Write it all down. Whether it's good, whether it's bad, in your view or their view, whether I'm angry, whether I'm pleased, etc. Write it down." So after that, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu anhuma, he became from the companions who narrated a great deal of hadiths and also wrote down a great deal of hadiths. Some say he wrote down more hadiths than Abu Hurairah, even though Abu Hurairah memorized more, and Abu Hurairah passed on more. And Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he lived for a very long time, and as Imam al-Bukhari and others have stated, there were over 800 students he had in Medina. So that's why his legacy flourished the way it flourished. What's important is Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, the Prophet informed him, he says, "Uktub." He says, "Write down what you hear me say." Why should you write down every single thing? Because every single thing that I say is the haq, is the truth. So with that being said, and this hadith also proves another thing, is that hadiths were written down in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. And hadiths that say, "Don't write down anything except for the Quran," aren't necessarily the most authentic hadiths. Hadiths that state, "Don't write down anything except for the Quran," aren't necessarily the most authentic hadiths, but that's another long discussion. What's important is, the Prophet ﷺ, he said that only truth comes out of his mouth, alayhi salatu wasalam. So based off of this narration, scholars of Islam, they say that every single hadith of the Prophet ﷺ is truth, authentic narration. And every hadith is special. Every hadith is based off of the divine inspiration that Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam received. Regardless whether it's the specific wording of Allah, Hadith Qudsi, or whether it's the meaning from that which he was taught in a dream, from that which Allah Azza wa Jal sent down upon him, etc. And the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam is revelation just like the Quran. And in many different narrations that prove all of this, such as when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Yughfar lishaheed kullu shay'in aw kullu dhanbin." He says that the martyr will be forgiven for everything. The martyr will be forgiven for everything. Every sin that you ever made, the martyr, he who dies fi sabilillah, will be forgiven. And he told the companions that. He walked away from the companions. Then he went back to them. And he said, "Yughfaru lishaheed kullu dhanb aw kullu dhanb illa dain sarani bihi Jibreel anifan." He made a correction. He said that the shaheed, the martyr, will be forgiven for each and every sin except for his debts. Except for his debts. That's something that won't be wiped away. Even being martyred in Allah's cause. How can you just change and switch? He said, "Sarani bihi Jibreel anifan." He says, "Jibreel just came and told me that. Jibreel came down and he told me that." So the narration shows that the Prophet's words, this is in the Quran. The Prophet's words sent down by Jibreel. is inspired and taught what to say and what not to say. And there are many, many other hadith that prove this as well, that the sunnah of the Prophet was revelation, just like the Quran was. Obviously, the Quranic recitation, the Quranic revelation having khasa'is, having mizat, having special distinguishing features. It's not the topic of our discussion. The point we're trying to make is one thing only. And that is what Muhammad says is all special. However, the scholars of Islam, they say, there are certain hadith which are more special than others. There's certain narrations which may have a more profound effect, a heart-warming, heart-melting effect more than others. And nothing about this is strange. The Qur'an al-Kareem itself, there are surahs and there are ayats which are more virtuous than others. There's nothing wrong with that, even though it's all the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet ﷺ, he told us that Surah Al-Ikhlas, he says, ta'dilu thuluth al-Qur'an. It's equal to a third of the Qur'an. And he also taught us about Allahu la ilaha illahu, that the Ayatul Kursi. And the Prophet ﷺ, he also told us with regards to other surahs and other ayats, Ismu Allah al-A'zam, idha du'iya bihi ajab, the greatest name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when Allah is asked by this name, he gives. So the Qur'an has certain surahs and certain ayats which are more virtuous than others. And the Prophet ﷺ's words, even though we've just proven, فَلَا يَخْرُجُ مِنْهُ إِلَّا الْحَقِّ, he says, nothing comes out of my mouth except for the truth. All of the hadith are the truth. But there's certain hadiths which are more virtuous than others. Certain hadiths which may have a better or more profound effect than others. And this was well known to the ulama. An example of this is the hadith of Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, the one on hadith of Sahih Muslim, hadith Qudsi, in which the Prophet quotes, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Ya Ibadi, he says, O my slaves, كُلُّكُمْ ضَالٌ إِلَّا مَنْ هَدَيْتُ فَاسْتَهْدُونِي أَهْدِكُمْ. He says, O my slaves, all of you are misled, quote unquote, or unaware, more accurate translation, except for those whom I guide. Seek my guidance, and I will guide you. Towards the end of the hadith, each and every one, كُلُّكُمْ جَائِعٌ إِلَّا مَنْ أَطْعَمْتُهُ فَاسْتَطْعِمُونَ, etc. All of you are hungry except for those whom I feed. Ask me for food, and I will feed you. Towards the end of the hadith, the ulama of Islam, they say there isn't a hadith that's more virtuous for Ahlul Sham, the Syrian scholars of hadith, than this one hadith. He says that's the best hadith that they have ever come across and narrated. And how many hadiths did the people of Sham narrate? Sham, just like many other countries, was a major center of hadith. Yet and still, they say this hadith is the grandest hadith that they have. Well, how can that? So the point is there are certain hadiths which have special meanings, certain hadiths which have special effect, certain hadiths which are considered to be virtuous more than others, more important than others. From those hadiths, is a famous hadith that you all know, a hadith that you can find in Imam Nawawi's small collection, and that is the narration of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, by Imam Tirmidhi, has been collected by Tirmidhi and others, in which the Prophet he gave Abdullah ibn Abbas nasiha, he gave him wasiya, he gave him advice, just like he gave all of the companions advice. And just like he, alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, ad-dinu nasiha, the religion is advice. And just like Jarir radiallahu anhu, he said in Sahih Bukhari, he said, bayatu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ala sam'i wa ta'a, bayatu Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam alayhi wa sallam alayhi wa zakat wa nusli kulli Muslim. He says, when I went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to give him my oath of allegiance, my bay'ah, I swear, I make an oath. He said, I gave him an oath upon the following things. Number one, it's to listen to him and to obey. It's to listen to the leader that he gives us and to obey that leader. He said to establish a prayer, establish the zakah, and he says, "Wa nushi li kulli Muslim," and to give advice to each and every single Muslim, to be an honest, transparent, open person to every single Muslim that I come across. So advice was for everyone. Wasiyah was for everyone. Now, the Prophet ﷺ, when he was asked in the hadith of Ibad ibn Sariyah radiallahu anhu, also by collected by Imam Tirmidhi and others, when they said "Ka'annaha," it says as if you're leaving us. Huh? وَسِيَّةُ مُوَدِّعٍ, as if you're leaving us, as if you're leaving this world. Give us some advice. فَأَوْسِينَا, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أُسِيكُمْ بِتَقُوا اللَّهِ وَالسَّمِي وَطَاعَةِ وَإِنْ تَأَمَّرَ عَلَيْكُمْ عَبْدٌ فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ فَسَيَرَ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي إِلَىٰ آخِرِ الْحَدِيثِ. He says, I give you wasiyya, advice to fear Allah, etc. So the Prophet ﷺ, he gave advice to everybody. The Prophet ﷺ, he gave advice to every single person. There's nothing that was special to Ibn Abbas. Yet and still, in this hadith, the Messenger of Allah ﷺ, he selected some advice only for Ibn Abbas. He gave advice only to Ibn Abbas. He gave him some special advice to Ibn Abbas. And this is one of the reasons why this hadith is considered to be so grand and so exquisite to the ulama. So grand, so exquisite, so important. Some of the ulama explained this hadith and talked about this hadith more than once. More than once. So the hadith is collected by At-Tirmidhi, the original collector. And hadith was also quoted by An-Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala. His 40 hadith is not an original source of hadith. You won't put in a book report. You won't say in a khutbah, as many people do, أخرجه النووي في الأربعين. هذا خطأ. النووي لم يسنده. ليس له إسناد إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في هذا الكتاب. وإنما مقتطف من كتب أخرى. مصادر أصلية. لا يقال في التخريج رواه النووي في الأربعين. الحديث أخرجه النووي في الأربعين. هذا غلط. أخرجه الترمذي كما ذكره النووي في الأربعين. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in this hadith, you don't say that Nawawi collected the hadith. The hadith is akhrajahu, it's been transmitted. No, hadith was transmitted by Tirmidhi and others. What they have in Isnad, hadathana, Mahmud ibn Ghaylan, for example, unto Ibn Abbas to the Prophet. Nawawi's book has no chains of narrations therein. Nawawi's book is a compilation from original sources of hadith. I'm disrespecting the book, I'm just trying to make a point, prove a point of the proper way of referencing a hadith. The proper way of referencing a hadith. Al-Muhim, what's important is, the hadith is inside of Nawawi's 40 collection. And who explained that book? Many ulama explained the book of Imam Nawawi from them is Ibn al-Rajab, rahimahullah. Al-Hafidh ibn Rajab, from the 8th century of Baghdad. He made a sharh of 42 hadiths that Nawawi collected, and he also added 8 more hadiths. So he made 50 hadiths, Ibn al-Rajab. Khamsun, 50. And he called his book Jami'ul Ulum wal Hikam fi sharhi 50 hadithan min Jawami'il Kalim. His famous book, Jami'ul Ulum wal Hikam, a compilation, a compendium of science and wisdom, knowledge and wisdom, an explanation of 50 comprehensive hadiths. No, we collected how many hadiths? He reported how many hadiths, or he compiled how many hadiths? 42 in his book. Not 40, but 42. Now, Ibn Rajab came behind the Nawawi. Nawawi died 676 of the Hijrah. He was from Sham. Ibn Rajab died 795 of the Hijrah. He was from Baghdad. He's from Iraq. So Nawawi, he compiled 42 hadiths. The 40 hadith of Nawawi. Naam. Ibn Rajab, he came years later after Nawawi, and he took his book and he did what? He added 8 more hadith to his collection. 8 hadith that he felt that were also just as powerful, just as comprehensive, and just as laconic as Nawawi's 42. Remember clear on this? And then after he put 8 hadiths with 42 making 50, he made a sharh of all of them. A comprehensive sharh, which is one of the best books to read, period. In Arabic and also in English. Jami'ul Ulum wal Hikam is one of the most important books for student knowledge to read, Imam of a Masjid to read, one of the most comprehensive books on Islam. Not hadith, on Islam. Jami'ul Ulum wal Hikam of Ibn Rajab. So in this book, Ibn Rajab, obviously he explained the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas, in which the Prophet ﷺ gave him the specific advice. He gave him one-on-one advice. Now, but the hadith was so special, the hadith was so important, as we said, the introduction that we were laying down, the hadith was so grand and exquisite, is that he decided to re-explain the hadith. Make another explanation of the hadith, bigger and longer, because the hadith deserved so much attention. Everybody understand this enough? The hadith is so important that I did the khutbah on it and the Friday night lecture, I did on the hadith as well. Even though I explained it in the khutbah, but now I'm going to talk about it again after Salat al-Maghrib for the family lecture, because the hadith is so what? So special. It's such a what? Special hadith that deserves so much time and so much attention. So Ibn Rajab, rahimahullah, after he made an extensive explanation of the hadith in the 40 hadith explanation, he came along and he wrote another book explaining the narration of Abdullah ibn Abbas, because the narration of Abdullah ibn Abbas is considered to be paramount to the ulama of Islam, just like the other narrations that we said as well, which are so special and so virtuous. He wrote a book, and in the name of the book, he called it Nurul Iqtibas fi Mishkati Wasiyat al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam liman? Huh? Ibn Abbas. Nurul Iqtibas. He called this book Nurul Iqtibas. He said the light of Iqtibas, the light of deduction, deducing and extracting light. Huh? From the lantern, Mishkat, the lamp of the Prophet's advice to who? Ibn Abbas. The Prophet's words were so special, so comprehensive, so meaningful to Ibn Abbas, that he wrote another what? Another book on it. Even though he previously explained it where? In the sharh of the 50 hadith. In the sharh of the what? 50 hadith, which originally the 40 hadith of Nawawi, 42 hadith. Everybody understand this? So he titled his book Nur al-Iqtibas. He's saying this hadith is a guiding light. It's a guiding light. It's something that the Prophet said to Ibn Abbas, and it's applicable to everybody else. And it's a major, 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 major paramount statement or statements of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So that's the name of his book. He says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Hamdan Kithiran Tayyiban Mubarakan Fee, Kama Yuhibbu Rabbuna wa Yardha, Wa Kama Yambaghi Li Karmi Wajhi Wa Izzi Jalalihi, Wa Sallallahu Ala Muhammadin Nabi Al Ummi, Wa Alihi Wa Sahbihi Wa Sallama Tasliman Kithiran, خرج الإمام أحمد من حديث حنش الصنعاني عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال كنت رديف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال يا غلام أو يا غليم ألا أعلمك كلمات ينفعك الله بهن فقلت بلى قال احفظ الله يحفظك احفظ الله تجده أمامك تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة وإذا سألت فاسأل الله وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله قد جف القلم بما هو كائن فلو أن الخلق كلهم جميعا أرادوا أن ينفعوك بشيء لم يقضه الله عليك لم يقدروا عليك وإن أرادوا أن يضروك بشيء لم يكتب الله عليك لم يكتبه الله عليك لم يقدروا عليه واعلم أن في الصبر على ما تكره خيرا كثيرا وأن النصر مع الصبر وأن الفرج مع الكرب وأن مع العسر يسرا. He says here, pay close attention. Anyone who's memorized the 40 hadith of Nawawi or familiar with the hadith, you can see how the wording is a bit different here. The wording is a bit different. And this is important to understand, is that when you study 40 hadith of Nawawi, Nawawi's book is nothing more than a primer. It's a muqaddimah. It's an introduction to the entire science. And in Nawawi, he may quote a hadith and he may word it in a way. It doesn't mean that hadith wording is like that in every single book, every other book. They're different wordings. Innamal a'malu binniyat. Does this necessarily say that in Sahih Bukhari with that word in? It may say innama al-amalu binniyya. Al-amalu binniyya. Everybody understand this? There's different alfaz, there's different wordings of one hadith. So Ibn Rajab rahimahullah, in the introduction to his book, he praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he says, Imam Ahmad has collected the narration of a man whose name is Hanish al-Sanani. He's from Yemen, who's the student of Ibn Abbas. And he reported that Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said, Kuntu Radif al Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He says, one day I was riding behind the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. You're riding on a horse, a donkey, a camel, two animals, one animal, I don't remember, I was riding behind him. And he said, Ya Ghulam. He said, oh young man. As we said in the khutbah, he didn't say, yo boy. Come, you young boy. He said, Ghulam, you're a young man, you're not a boy. Even though you're not of age, you're not that old, but you will be old soon enough, inshaAllah ta'ala. You will be a man one day. So he said, Ya Ghulam. And another version says that he said, Ya Ghulayyim, Ala u'allimuka kalimatin. And Nawawi's hadith, he says, Inni u'allimuka aw mu'allimuka. He says, Ala u'allimuka. He says, let me teach you some words of advice. Let me give you some special advice, O Ibn Abbas. He says, perhaps Allah Azza wa Jal will benefit you. Perhaps Allah will help you out through my words. And this is a tremendous benefit from the beginning of the hadith, is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was not the one who gave benefit to the Sahaba. And Nabi al-Kareem alayhi salatu wasalam, he wasn't the Nafi al-Dar. He wasn't the one who gave benefit to the Sahaba. The Nabi al-Kareem alayhi salatu wasalam, with all love and respect, he was not the one who brought harm or benefit to the people. He was nothing more than a messenger. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasalam tells us in the other hadith, مَنْ يُرِدْ لَهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِهُ فِي الدِّينِ وَإِنَّمَا أَنَا قَاسِمُ إِنَّمَا أَنَا قَاسِمُ وَاللَّهُ يُعْطِي. He says, whoever Allah wants good for, He gives him fiqh of the religion. وَإِنَّمَا أَنَا قَاسِمُ. That's all I have, is to pass out. All I do is distribute. And Allah Azza wa Jalla is the mu'ti. He's the one who actually what? He gives. Allah is the one who gives. All I do is pass out and hand out what Allah actually gives. So he says, يَنْفَعَكَ اللَّهُ بِهِنَّ. He says, Allah will give you nafi', inshaAllah, with my words. How many people today say Muhammad himself guided the people? Muhammad himself cured the people. Muhammad himself prevented himself from death right here in this masjid. Right here, what? In this masjid. He said, Muhammad is not dead. You can't say that. You can't say that. So you can't say that Muhammad has died. He told me, he said, study. He said, udrus al-qadiyya. He said, go back and study the issue some more, oh young one. Muhammad has not what? Passed away. And the reason why he didn't pass away is because, subhanAllah, he said, shaitan, he said, I will lead all of the sons of Adam away, ajma'in. He says, has the devil's message stopped? I said, of course not. The devil's message is continuous. He says, so how can Muhammad's message have stopped? If the shaitan is still alive and still working, then that means what? Muhammad still has to be what? Alive and what? Working as well. He says, you can't say that. Right here in this masjid, let alone masjids, Allah musta'an, nowhere upon any type of sunnah and ilm and knowledge. So this is why I spread. Many Muslims, they think that Muhammad himself was the one who gave benefit, was the one who caused harm. Muhammad was the one who had these special miraculous powers. And that's wrong. And it's not wrong according to the ulama. It's not wrong according to Ibn Taymiyyah or Ibn Abdul Wahhab or Ibn Baz or Ibn Uthaymeen. It's wrong according to whose words? Muhammad himself. He said, يَنْفَعَكَ اللَّهُ بِهِنَّ. He says, Allah will give you the benefit through my what? My words. إِنَّمَا أَنَا قَاسِمْ وَاللَّهُ. I only disperse it. Allah is the actual endower. He's the one who blesses and who gives it. So he said, let me teach you some words, O young man. Perhaps Allah Azza wa Jal will give you a benefit. And we see here, from the styles of teaching, من أساليب التعليم والتربية, from the ways of teaching, is to present something to the learner. It's to offer it to the learner. First and foremost, there's a major manifestation of humility. A major manifestation of being mutawadir, humble. Secondly, it opens up the mind of the learner. Instead of you just saying it, it opens up his mind. It gets him interested to what's going to be said. Thirdly, it gives the learner a sense of value and respect. Whereas the learner has the choice and the option. Can I teach you something? Can I share something with you, akhi? And not, I'm going to throw it on you and force it on you. Everybody understand this? First, the first point, if we said, يعني من مظاهر التربية والتنشية, we talk about cultivation, Islamic cultivation. Very important topic. And a very often spoken, people, they speak about this topic very often. But oftentimes people, they don't necessarily do it the right way. They don't tackle it from the organic source. The best way to learn Tarbiyah Islamiyah is right from the Sunnah, directly. Right from the Sunnah. The first point of Tarbiyah is that the Prophet ﷺ, he said what to Ibn Abbas? He said what? Ya Ghulam, Ya Ghulayim, oh young man. And he didn't say, oh you, oh Fulan, oh son of Adam, oh boy. He gave him Ghulam. He gave him a sense of worth, respect. So that's going to make him want to listen now. Next, he said, Ala o Alimuka. He says, can I teach you some words? Did the Prophet ﷺ have to ask a question? Did he have to seek permission? Did the Prophet ﷺ have to make a suggestion to young man Ibn Abbas? No, he didn't. So every great man, every great leader, every knowledgeable person is always humble. That's the sign of a true scholar, the sign of a true leader is that he's what? He's humble, he's low. I'm on the front line just like you are. We're both suffering and struggling in this battle together, and not I'm above. And that is the thing, that is the magic on the people's hearts. That has an effect upon the nufus. He's the leader. He came all the way down just to eat lunch with us. Everybody understand this? He's the head honcho, he's in top. How many things does he have to do? How busy is he? And he found time to do what? To come and sit and eat with us and talk with us. That has an effect upon the people. That has an effect. So the Prophet ﷺ, he asked Ibn Abbas, he says, can I teach you some words? Ibn Abbas, he said, فَقُلْتُ بَلَى. Taban, of course, O Messenger of Allah. Of course you can teach me some words. He said, اِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ يَحْفَظْكَ. The first point of advice that he gave him was, protect Allah. اِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ. Look after Allah. يَحْفَظْكَ. Allah will look after you. Allah will protect you. That's the very first thing that he said. After he said that, he told him, اِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ تَجِدْهُ أَمَامَكَ. Not تُجَاهَكَ. He says, protect Allah, and you'll find that Allah will always be in front of you. Always. If you're mindful of Allah, Allah will be there for you. He then said, تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة. He says, acquaint yourself with Allah in times of prosperity. when things are going easy, things are going smoothly. Know Allah. Have a relationship with Allah, and Allah Azza wa Jalla will know you at the times of shidda, at the times of difficulty, when things aren't going smooth, Allah will know you. Now, it's a very interesting point, Samir. هل يقال وهل يوصف الله بالمعرفة ولا العلم؟ العلم لا المعرفة. لماذا؟ أليس هذا الحديث يثبت هذا؟ يعرفك في الشدة. من باب المشاكل أو المقابلة. طيب ما الإشكال أن نصف الله بالمعرفة؟ هل هناك إشكال أصلا؟ لا إشكال؟ ما الإشكال أصلا؟ مكتسب بعد أن لم يكن علم مكتسب. هذا إشكال كبير جدا. إذا جاء في الكتاب والسنة وصف الله بالمعرفة هذا الذي نثبت سواء كان مكتسبا أم على عندنا نحن، لأنهم يؤولون صفة المحبة بأنها ميلان القلب، وصفة الغضب بأنه انتبه، صح ولا لا؟ نقول جاء في الكتاب والسنة وصف الله بالعلم اسما وصفة وفعلا وأثرا، وأما المعرفة فقد ورد في هذا الحديث. فإذا كان كذلك هكذا نثبت. أما أن الفرق بين العلم والمعرفة أنه معلومات مكتسبة، فإذا سلمت بهذه المقدمة سوف تقع فيه، عرفت كيف؟ هذا أولا. ثانيا مثل ما قلت من باب المشاكلة. ثالثا يقول أهل العلم إن باب الصفات أوسع من باب الأسماء، إن باب الأفعال أوسع من باب الصفات، إن باب الإخبار عن الله أوسع من باب الأفعال. انتبه، هناك الأسماء بعدين الصفات بعدين الأفعال بعدين الإخبار. هناك ضوابط علمية مهمة جدا لطالب العلم في باب الأسماء والصفات، ضوابط علمية مهمة جدا تفهم بها مئات الآيات والحديث والنصوص، ولا يعني يشكل عليك شيء بإذن الله تعالى. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he says that if you acquaint yourself with Allah, Allah will know you. Acquaint yourself when things are going good, and Allah will know you when things aren't so good. He then said, and whenever you ask, ask Allah. And whenever you wish for help, you need help and assistance, seek my assistance. Huh? He didn't say seek my assistance. Come to my grave and ask me for assistance. The Prophet never ever said that. He said, فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. Seek the help of the one who helps me and you. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He then said, قَدْ جَفَّ الْقَلَمُ بِمَا هُوَ كَائِنٌ. Once again, it's different than the version in 40 hadith. He said that the pen is dried up. Whatever is going to take place and exist is no more. It's not being written down anymore. فَلَوْ أَنَّ الْخَلْقَ كُلَّهُمْ جَمِيعًا. And then he goes on to the end of the hadith. He says, if everyone came together to help you out, they can't help you out unless Allah decreed it upon you. And if they came together to hurt you or bother you, they couldn't do that unless Allah Azza wa Jalla decreed that upon you. Know for sure, victory comes through patience. Victory comes through patience. Know for sure that victory comes through patience. Winning the game comes through patience, not haste. Look at the Prophet ﷺ's tarbiyah once more. What is one of the most distinguishing features of a young man? Is what? Haste. It's one of the most distinguishing features of a youth is haste, a taish. He's hasty, jumping all over the place. So the Prophet ﷺ, he gave him a pill. He gave him medicine for a major cancer, a major sickness and illness, a major fault of young people. And that is haste. That's what? That's haste. Look how the Prophet ﷺ talked to a young man. And look what that young man what? Became, as we said. What that young man became. He then said, وَأَنَّ الْفَرَجَ مَعَ الْكَرْبِ. He says, and that Allah's divine help comes at the time of difficulty. Al-karb, when it's calamity, that's when you know it's what? The victory is coming soon. The help is coming soon. That's what the captain of the ship says. He says, I think this will be our finest hour. The people says, we're going to die. We're going down. He says, this is going to be our what? Our finest hour. And that's why he's the what? He's the captain. He has more knowledge than him. He has more forbearance than him. He knows that when things get really, really tight, that's the sign of things getting what? Better. Last but not least, he says, وَأَنَّ مَعَلُ أُسْرِ يُسْرًا. And with ease, or he says, with the difficulty comes what? Comes hardship. So before we read what Ibn Rajab said about this hadith in brief, we don't have time to mention the whole entire explanation in this book. The point is what, brothers and sisters? Is that this hadith in itself could be studied for an entire week. You can have an entire conference on this one hadith. When you talk about tarbiyah, you talk about teaching your children aqidah, we better clear on this. You talk about teaching, ta'leem, having a student of knowledge, a disciple from young, and raising him from what? From young, and allowing him to learn and to seek. Because the Prophet ﷺ did not teach Ibn Abbas everything. Ibn Abbas did not learn everything with the Prophet ﷺ. As we said yesterday, Ibn Abbas, he was a young man, 13, 14 years old, barely, when the Prophet ﷺ had passed away. Where did he get all that knowledge from? Who did he learn from? There are other ways and there are other sources. What's important is, as a teacher, the most important job as a teacher is to do one thing and one thing only. Not to teach your student everything. You don't have to teach your student everything. You don't have to teach your son everything. You don't have to teach your daughter everything. The most important and substantial task is annak taghris, is that you plant the seed in their mind and in their heart, and that's it. If you can successfully do that, then the rest they themselves will do. Plant the seed, plant the inspiration, plant the desire in the mind and in the heart of your student. Give him the way to think, the proper understanding, the proper philosophy, the taste. And then bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, with the barakah of Allah, the student will do the rest by his what? By himself. If you live long, he lives long, and he stays with you for a very long time, alhamdulillah, you teach him actual information. If the only thing that I came to Toronto and I met you, and I inspired you, and I told you do this and do that, go overseas and study, and that's the last time that I met you, that will be what? More than sufficient. If you truly want to benefit and study knowledge. As far as if you just want to keep talking and sitting and eating, what about this? Ya Sheikh, I have a question. Ya Sheikh, I have a su'al. Ya Sheikh, any su'al, I have another question. I have a third, I have a fourth, I have a fifth, I have a sixth, a seventh, an eighth question. And then I come back the next year to Toronto and it's the same thing. Nothing has changed. I come back a third year to Toronto, nothing has changed. All the different bits and pieces that I gave you, more, I gave you a bag of seeds. Not one seed, a what? A bag of seeds. And there aren't any shrubs, any bushes, no trees, nothing has grown. Then one or two things is wrong now. Either I failed or the soil is no good. I myself have done a poor job, or the soil itself is what? It isn't fertile at all. It's not good, and you're not made to be a seeker of knowledge. The Prophet ﷺ seeds, bi-idhnillah, they were blessed. And the soil of Abdullah ibn Abbas, their lives no doubt was rich and fertile. And that's why Ibn Abbas became from the greatest of the ulama of the Sahaba. They called him al-Bahr, Bahr al-Ummah. They called him the sea, the ocean, the Pacific Ocean, the Atlantic Ocean of the Muslims. Because his knowledge was so vast. And it was also so what? So deep, oceanic. Everybody understand this? So the main thing we want to focus on this morning, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, is one point from the hadith. And that is when the Prophet ﷺ says, Ibn Rajab, he says, فَقَوْلُهُ إِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ يَحْفَظْكَ يعني احفظ حدود الله وحقوقه وأوامره ونواهيه وحفظ ذلك هو الوقوف عند أوامره بالامتثال وعند النواهي بالاجتناب وعند حدوده فلا تتجاوز ولا تتعدى ما أمر به إلى ما نهى عنه فدخل في ذلك فعل الواجبات جميعا وترك المحرمات كلها كما في حديث أبي ثعلبة المرفوع أو أبي ثعلبة المرفوع إن الله فرض فرائض فلا تضيعوها وحرم حرمات أو أساس حرمات فلا تنتهكوها وحد حدودا فلا تعتدوها وذلك كله يدخل في حفظ حدود الله كما ذكره الله في قوله والحافظون لحدود الله الآية وقال تعالى هذا ما توعدون لكل أواب حفيظ من خشي الرحمن بالغيب وجاء بقلب منيب وفسر الحفيظ هاهنا بالحافظ لأوامر الله وفسر بالحافظ للذنوب حتى يرجع منها وكلاهما يدخل في الآية ومن حفظ وصية الله لعباده وامتثلها فهو داخل أيضا والكل يرجع إلى معنى واحد وقد ورد في بعض ألفاظ حديث يوم المزيد في الجنة أن الله تعالى يقول لأهل الجنة إذا استدعاهم إلى زيارته وكشف لهم الحجب مرحبا بعبادي الذين حفظوا وصيتي وروعوا عهدي وخافوا بالغيب وكانوا مني على كل حال مشفقين ف فأمره صلى الله عليه وسلم أو فأمره صلى الله عليه وسلم لابن عباس بحفظ الله يدخل فيه هذا كله. ومن أعظم ما يجب حفظه من المأمورات الصلوات الخمس. قال تعالى: حافظوا على الصلوات والصلاة الوسطى. وقال: والذين هم على صلاتهم يحافظون. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من حافظ عليها كان له عند الله عهدا أن يدخله الجنة. الحديث. وفي حديث آخر: من حافظ عليهن كن له نورا وبرهانا ونجاة يوم القيامة. الحديث. وكذلك الطهارة فإنها مفتاح الصلاة. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: لا يحافظ على الوضوء إلا مؤمن، فإن العبد تنتقض طهارته ولا يعلم بذلك إلا الله. فالمحافظة على الوضوء للصلاة دليل على ثبوت الإيمان في القلب. ومما أمر الله بحفظه الإيمان لما ذكر كفارة يمين. طيب، قال ابن رجب: ومما أمر الله بحفظه الإيمان لما ذكر كفارة اليمين، قال: ذلك كفارة أيمانكم إذا حلفتم واحفظوا أيمانكم. فإن الأيمان كثيرا ما تقع من الناس وموجباتها مختلفة، فتارة يجب بها كفارة يمين، وتارة يجب بها كفارة مغلظة، وتارة يلزم بها المحلوف عليه من طلاق ونحوه. فمن حفظ أيمانه دل على دخول الإيمان في قلبه. وكان السلف كثيرا يحافظون على الأيمان، فمنهم من كان لا يحلف بالله البتة، ومنهم من كان يتورع وحتى يكفر عما شك في الحنث فيه. ووصل الإمام أحمد رحمه الله عند موته أن تخرج عنه كفارة يمين، وقال: أظن أني حنثت في يمين حلفتها. ابن رجب, he says, when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, the first piece of advice was احفظ الله. He said, protect Allah. Literal meaning, to protect Allah. What does this mean? Obviously, us today, what we're going to say, Samir, Allah, كيف نحفظ الله? كيف نحفظ? كيف? How can we protect Allah? It really means this, and we don't translate. The Prophet did not say that. And if the wording, listen carefully, we're not talking about the meaning, but if the wording was mushkil, if the wording was unbefitting of Allah, then the Prophet wouldn't have what? Aslan, in those words. Let alone the meaning. We know that no one can protect Allah. No one can protect Allah, Azza wa Jalla. Allah, He's the one who protects. We know this. But the actual wording, the point I'm trying to get to in talking to the talib of the ilm, is how these different aqa'id and these ta'wilat, they creep in. They creep in. Everybody understands they what? They creep in. And then you start saying things, ma'rifah, ilm, so on and so forth, because they what? They creep in. The Prophet said, ihfadillah. I don't have to put in my translation, protect the rulings of Allah. I don't have to say that in translation. In the translation, I say what, Ilyas? Protect Allah. As the Prophet himself, what? Said it. What does it mean to protect Allah? That's Adi. To protect Allah's rulings, no problem. But the word in itself isn't what? Isn't a problem. The love of itself, la yishkir. And the Prophet, he was more pious than you. He was more knowledgeable than you. And he was alam wa'araf bima yastahidu wa bima wa bima wa ma. Everybody understand this? And tabihu li anfusikum ya talabat al-ilm. هذه التأويلات والعقائد لها تأثير حتى على السنة على طلبة السنة انتبهوا. He says احفظ الله, protect Allah, and Allah will protect you. You can't say that about Allah. You can't say that, you can't word it like that. You have to say in the translation, protect the rulings of Allah. Right or wrong? Right or wrong? That's wrong. Rather, it is permissible to say protect Allah, and the meaning of that is what? Well known. Everybody understand this? So he said, احفظ الله يحفظك. Listen carefully to how comprehensive this hadith is. Ibn Rajab, he said, this means, he says, يعني, it means, احفظ حدود الله. Protect the hudud of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The set boundaries of the halal and the haram. The rights of Allah. The commandments of Allah. The prohibitions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what's meant by protecting these things is to stop and comply to Allah's commandments, and to move forward and to implement Allah's, he says, to stop and to comply to the commandments, and to stop, avoid the prohibitions. He says, included in this hadith is the entire religion. The entire religion. Anything that you do of good, anything that you avoid of bad is included in this one sentence. احفظ الله يحفظك. Everybody understand this? You make salah in the morning, that's included where? That's included in what? Salat al-Fajr and Jama'ah is included in what? احفظ الله يحفظك. Avoiding zina, avoiding drinking of khamar, knowing your gaze when you go to the mall, the marketplace, the supermarket, that's included in what? احفظ الله يحفظك. Protect Allah, Allah will protect you. Everything that you do, everything that you avoid is included in this one sentence. So look how tremendous the advice was to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Everybody clear on this or not? Afterwards he then says, as the hadith of Abu Tha'laba says, that indeed Allah has made fara'id. Allah has made things, injunctions. He has made rules. فَلَا تُضَيِّعُوهَا. Don't waste them. How can you say the iman is just in your heart now? Al-imanu fi al-qalb. Bas. Allah knows what's in my heart. The Prophet, he never ever said that. That iman is just in the heart. The Prophet, he said that there are physical rules that are not to be what? Wasted. So it's very sad, the secular lifestyle and the nominal lifestyle that many, many of us live on a daily basis in the lands of the Muslims, not just Canada, in the Middle East, in Africa, in Asia. There's the mosque, there's Friday, and then that's it. There's the mosque that you go to on Friday. What type of money you make, your work, what do? Your recreation, your sports, that's not Islam. Iman is just in the heart. And if you have a beard, if you say you have to wear hijab, if you avoid this, you say you're extreme. You don't understand Islam properly. You're too harsh. That's not Islam. You don't have to, dress code is not from Islam. How you eat, right hand, left hand, same as that, that's extreme. That's culture. This is what it said today. That's what? They say these things are what? It's cultural practices. That's not actual Islam. The Prophet himself, he said, فَلَا تُضَيِّعُوهَا. He says, don't waste these fara'id. Let's ask ourselves a common question. What good is a religion that's never ever followed? What good is it? What good is it then being a rule and it's never ever what? Followed. What's the purpose of it then? Why did Allah even send it down if it was sufficient just to believe in your heart? And that's it. And nothing physical, nothing that's tangible. That's irrational. That doesn't make sense. Let alone faith. That doesn't make what? It doesn't make sense. If the stoplight is there, you don't even have to stop. Just keep going. Why did they spend the time, the money, and the energy in making the stop sign or the stoplight if you never, ever have to stop at the light? So the Prophet ﷺ is quoted in this hadith, he said, فَلَا تُضَيِّعُوهَا. And he made things that are haram. فَلَا تَنْتَهِكُوهَا. Don't fall therein. And he made hudud. Don't transgress them. He says, all of this is included in the concept of حِفْظُ حُدُودِ اللَّهِ. As Allah says in Surah At-Tawbah, وَالْحَافِظُونَ لِحُدُودِ اللَّهِ. Allah praises those who make muhafaza, who strictly guard Allah's hudud. Moving forward, he mentions the ayah from Surah Qaf, in which Allah Azza wa Jal says, هَذَا مَا تُعَدُونَ. He says, this is the promise, لِكُلِّ أَوَّابٍ حَفِيظٍ. For every slave, every servant who has these two attributes, he's awab, yani kathir at-tawbah, raja ila tawbah. He's always going back to repentance, and he is hafidh. He's someone who memorizes, who protects. Listen carefully. He says there are two interpretations of this ayah. Two interpretations. The hafidh, he says first and foremost, al-hafidhuni awamirillah, is the one who strictly guards Allah's commandments. He said, I'm hafidh of the Quran, meaning that you memorize the Quran, and you're strictly guarding the what? The Quran. You have it all in your heart, and nothing escapes. Everybody understand this? A guard. What does a sentry do? He stands post. This prisoner is not supposed to do what? He's not supposed to do what? He's not supposed to leave. He's not supposed to what? Leave. No one is supposed to enter his room or leave his room except through his permission. He's a hafiz. He's guarding. So that's the first meaning. The second meaning is he's memorized his sins. He has a sharp eye on his what? His sins. How many of us know how many are our sins? Allahumma musta'an. Not every single sin. But we're talking about how many of us have an idea of what we really need to make tawbah from, honestly. There are many of us, we don't even know. We're not even aware. We made so many sins over and over again, we can't even begin to keep count. If you can't keep counting your sins, you can't keep basic track of your sins, then the question is, how can you do what? Make tawbah from them. How can you do what? Make tawbah from them. Everybody understand this? You sit your son down at the kitchen table. You admonish your son for doing something bad, your teenage son, and he says, I'm sorry, all right? I'm sorry, give me a break, I'm sorry. What's the first thing you're going to say to him? What would you say to your son, the first thing, your teenage son? What would you say to him first? He's saying sorry to get you off of his back, right? What would you tell him? What would you tell him? Huh? Ask him what he did. You're going to say, how are you going to say sorry from something and you don't even know what you did wrong? You didn't even acknowledge your mistake. You don't even know why what you did was so bad. You're just saying sorry because of me. You can't make Tawbah from something and you actually don't even what? Know what you did wrong. So this shows you the virtue of this Muslim who is aware of his own what? Flaws and shortcomings. Ibn Rajab, he then says here, quoting some more ayat and hadith with regards to Hifdhu Hududillah. One of them he says, and it's the last thing that I want to mention in this class today, the greatest thing that a person is to guard and to look after is the prayer. Like we mentioned last night after Isha. That is the most important thing. Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, "Inna ahamma amalikum indi as-salah." He says, the most important thing for you to do for me is prayer. That's what he said to his governors, his ummah. And that's what you say to your son and your daughter. That's what the teacher is supposed to say to his students. The most important thing for you to look after is the what? Is the prayer. He said here, Allah says, "Hafidhu ala salawat." Strictly guard all of your prayers. وَالصَّلَاةِ الْوُسْطَى. And the middle prayer. وَالَّذِينَهُمْ. He says, and those who strictly guard their prayers. The Prophet ﷺ, he says, he who strictly guards the prayers will have a promise with Allah. Not for Allah to put him into paradise. Another narration says, it will be a means of light. It will be a proof. It will be a means of success and salvation on the Day of Judgment. And another hadith says, with regards to the key to the prayer, the miftah of the salah, which is wudu, that no one strictly guards wudu except for a what? A believer. What does this hadith mean? No one will strictly guard his wudu except for a believer. Kaif. What does this mean? لا يحافظ على الوضوء إلا مؤمن. ما وجه هذا الشيء؟ كيف؟ Why is it so special and important to strictly guard wudu? Huh? Keep your mind in salah, perhaps. Hirzan min ash-shaytan, protection from the devil. طيب, perhaps. What else? He's always prepared for salah. طيب. What else? تفضل. Acceptance of the prayer. طيب. الطهارة شطر الإيمان. Half of one's faith. طيب. Getting closer. Who knows when you break your wudu? Everybody? If I ask you right now, Mahdi, do I have wudu or not? Do you know? You don't know. I can stand up and pray and make salat al-duha or ishraq, as some say, and you don't know what I have. I might have no wudu at all. No one knows when I break my wudu. I go to sleep. You leave me in my hotel room, but I never slept that night. I could have stayed up all night praying. But I put on my pajamas, Samir. Huh? Cut off the light. See you in the morning. Tusbih ala khair. In actuality, I never ever what? Slept. Like you said in Ottawa, huh? I'm staying up at night, but I'm telling you I'm going to sleep. You have to, so you can hide your qiyam, right? We said this in Ottawa, right? No one knows what I'm doing. I could be asleep. I could stay up. I can keep my wudu. I may break my wudu. That is the wudu is a secret between who? You and Allah Azza wa Jalla. So the moment you break your wudu and you make it again or you keep your wudu, that shows that iman has truly penetrated one's what? It's penetrated your heart because you're constantly in a state of conscientiousness about Allah, about the salah, about hirs min ash-shaytan, about the conditions of the prayer, about hakim. Everybody understand this? That's why the Prophet has been saying that no one will strictly guard wudu unless he is a what? A mu'min. This hadith also smashes secularism as well. He's saying to make wudu is a major act of what? Iman, let alone praying five times a day. They asked the woman, the mother of the boys, the family of the boys that were considered, Allah knows best, I wasn't there, I don't know, considered to have carried out a terrorist attack. And they said, or they asked the parents, they said, what happened to your son or your sons? How did they become, quote unquote, radical or radicalized? What made them want to blow themselves up and blow up other people? What made them commit suicide and kill those people? What made them do that? It's narrated that the mother said the boys, they became extreme. They became extremely radicalized in Islam. So they asked her, how did they become extreme? How did you know when they were becoming radicalized? She said they started praying five times a day. That was the sign that my sons were going away from the balanced, moderate path of Islam. She said when they started praying five times a day, consistently, she says, I knew that my sons were radicalized. That's really sad. It's a horrible statement to make. And it goes to show you the mindset of many Muslims today. Strictly guarding the prayer, doing the basic things of Islam and Iman, you have to be a what? An extremist. You're automatically a terrorist. by doing the things that the Prophet ﷺ said do. The Prophet said to grow the beard. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, لَا يُحَافِظَ عَلَى الْوُضُوءِ إِلَى الْمُؤْمِنِ. No one will strictly guard wudu for passing wind, using the restroom. Is it haram to pass wind? Is it haram to use the restroom? No, it's not. Is it haram to eat the meat of a camel? It's not. It's not haram. But the virtue of keeping your wudu shows iman. And we live in a time in which the people say that iman is just in the heart. And the physical actions of the deen are not from the deen. And that's either culture, or extremism, or Wahhabism. What made your sons radical? She didn't say that. Well, what? How did you know that they were being radicalized? They were becoming terrorists. She said they start making 5 prayers a day. Every single day they prayed on time. And that's what led them to be terrorists. I.e., her herself, she doesn't make? No, we can't say that she doesn't make salat. No. She's not praying what? 5 times a day. Husband, the other sons, in one household, they're not praying 5 times a day. And if you do pray 5 times a day, or some communities, you go to the masjid 5 times a day, then people start looking at you and bothering you and investigating you. Who's this person that keeps going to the masjid with a beard? He has to be radical. It's a very sad state that we live in. And it's very important for us to be constantly vigilant and aware of what iman is and what iman isn't. Iman is a statement and an action, inwardly and outwardly. Inwardly and outwardly. And Islam is never ever made to be a secular religion. It's never made to be a nominal religion. It's not a faith. It's a way of life. Outside, inside, on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. Nobody's perfect. Everyone has mistakes. But the thing that cannot have a flaw in the mistake is our understanding and our conceptualization of Islam. That can never ever leave. I'm not the best Muslim. I'm not the biggest Muslim. I'm not the most knowledgeable person. I don't have the most, but I know what's correct. I know what's what? Correct. And you can never ever strip that from me. Allah forgive me. Allah have mercy on me. May Allah help me out. But I know that that's right and I know that that's wrong. And anyone saying if you pray 5 times a day, you're a terrorist. That's not right. No. Praying 5 times a day keeps you away from all the sin and evil acts. So we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to allow us to benefit from this hadith. If you get a chance, be the night out of those who speak Arabic and read Arabic, go back to the book, Nur al-Iqtibas of Hafidh ibn Rajab, rahimahullah ta'ala. You can find the book, Fi Majmu'at Rasail ibn Rajab. I don't know if the book has been translated in English, maybe it has, maybe it hasn't. Allah Azza wa Jal surely knows best. The Jami' al-Umm al-Hikm is in English several times. Jazakumullah khairan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala surely knows best. Wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
جزا الله شيخ